Hello and welcome to another Critique the Community. Today we're going to be doing a critique of 20 telephoto landscape photos. But before we get into today's critique, let me tell you about the next one. You can sign up for it right now and submit your pictures. The exciting thing about the next critique is that we have a new contest system that Joe, our web guru, has made.
Finally!
I know, and it's so much better now. And here's what's going to happen. You can go to the link in the YouTube video, go to the link on this post if you're watching this on Fstoppers. And you can submit images now. You can submit as many images as you want. And what it's going to do is it's going to keep all of the submissions in a very easy to see area where you can quickly cycle through all of the submissions and you guys can rate all of the images as well. We get a lot of complaints from people saying, ah, I upload pictures to the Fstoppers community, nobody rates my images. So now Patrick and I, we guarantee you that we personally will rate every single one of the images in the next critique. You know, you won't know that it's us, but you will get ratings on the images. And then in the next critique, we're gonna pick 20 images, we're gonna critique them, and then we're also going to show you what the community rated the pictures.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, so we can see how full of shit we are.
Yeah.
And maybe we are, you know, right on the money. Maybe we're totally wrong. So I'm really excited about that. Make sure you sign up for the next critique. We're going to do something ultra broad. It's going to be just portraits.
Any kind of portrait.
Any kind of portrait. The idea here is we want a lot of submissions for this one. And here's the other exciting thing. We're now going to be giving away 2 tutorials per critique.
What?
I know. I'm blowing your mind here.
We have to keep up with so much now.
So we always choose one random person who's going to win a free tutorial based on a number that you're gonna choose in just a second. But from now on, we're gonna do that as well as the highest rated image that the community rates on each one of these contests or these critiques. You're also going to get a free tutorial, and maybe in the future we're gonna have even better prizes than that. I know, my mind is blown as well. Let's get to this.
So how many do we have here? We have 20.
20
Somebody's
images.
Somebody's gonna win a tutorial here.
Yeah, we pick a number.
3, 2, 1.
10.
10.
Okay. I don't have 10.
What do you mean you don't have 10?
So I'm cycling through all these images right now and I'm realizing that I picked 19 images, not 20. So it goes from number 9 to number 11.
What kind of luck? That's a coincidence right there.
Pick another one.
Let's do 9.
9, okay. When we get to 9, that will be the winner of the tutorial.
How did I know that?
I don't know. All right, let's rate this first one here.
All right. Well, hold on.
What?
I haven't even looked at it.
Okay.
And what is the category?
Telephoto landscape photography. Anything above 50 millimeters is what we said. 3, 2, 1. I gave this 4. It's interesting. I was the one who actually had to pick all these images, and I click on this image, and I realized that I had previously rated this image a 3.
Mm.
And I actually changed my vote to a 4. Something about this, like, I really like it.
I mean, for the content that it is, I feel like it's done as well as it possibly can. I just don't know that I really find this that interesting. It's well done, but at the same time, if this popped up as the first image in your portfolio, which is kind of the idea behind rating these, I would immediately kind of say, ooh, this guy hasn't found enough interesting content.
See, I would agree with you if he was a normal photographer, but if he was a fine artist, a fine art landscape photographer.
You think somebody who prints fine art and puts it on their walls wants an image of power lines?
I really like this. I don't know, but for some reason I gave it 3 stars whenever long ago I rated it. I've updated it to a 4, but next image. I saw this one and instantly thought of the Peter Lick shot. This is more realistic of what,
yeah, the moon,
what it would look like.
The moon
like.
Or the sun, yeah, is slightly out of focus, which, but does that make it a better picture than Peter Lick's?
I don't think so. 3, 2, 1. 2 stars, needs work. This picture is tough, and when I clicked on this picture, I saw the rest of this photographer's portfolio. All of his pictures are super telephoto shots of the moon.
Okay. So there's probably a lot of technique and a lot of planning that,
yeah,
goes into it.
Exactly. So, you know, you have to give that person a lot of respect, but I always ask myself, like, what do you do with photos like this? It's really cool technically, But you know, the whole thing's kind of blurry and it's kind of ugly and grungy
looking.
What is
going on with the cross here? Is the cross on top of a second cross?
I was trying to figure that out too, because it looks like the cross is casting a shadow back on the moon, but I think it's just another cross.
Two crosses or something?
I think so. This
is tough because I feel like it's just shot at the wrong time of day, but it's the perfect time of day to get the moon right there. This is the moon, right?
It has to be the moon. Yeah, it has to be.
So, on one hand, it's the perfect time of night, but on the other hand, it needs to be some kind of composited blur, you know, blended shot to get the foreground to look good. Even then, I don't know that this subject matter is that exciting.
Here's the bummer with all of this, is that Peter Lick will do it fake in Photoshop and sell it for hundreds of thousands of dollars. But the people who do it for real, like this, I'm not saying that like this specific shot is as good as it gets, but like telephoto shots of the moon, like this is kind of as good as it gets. Shooting across the horizon like this, nothing's going to look sharp. Nothing's going to look very good.
Yeah.
So it's
one of those weird things where in your mind, you're like, oh my gosh, the moon's so beautiful. If I could just take a picture of it right now, but it never really translates that well.
Right. All right, next up. Now, I would have never known this, but I'm just going to say, this is the same photographer as the first shot.
You picked two of the same images.
Without knowing.
Okay.
But after I uploaded it to the computer, I clicked on the portfolio and then I was like, oh, I actually had picked three from this photographer and I deleted one out of here because I was like, oh, I can't have three of the same photographer.
All right.
Three, two, one. I'm going five. I'm in between a four and a five on this. Like, this looks amazing to me. That bird that's back there really makes this shot too. I would love to see this printed big. But again, there's nothing like mind-blowing about it. But in terms of fine art, this is the stuff that I like.
How telephoto, can you look at this image and tell what this was shot at? I'm sure a lot of people would want to know, is this a 50? Is this a, this isn't a 200. What could this be?
No. I don't know. I really don't know.
What was the category, what was the stipulation?
I think we said over 50 millimeters.
Okay.
So, you know, certainly not.
I remember going into art galleries when I was a kid, where, like really art galleries were just like print, like, mat stores and frame stores, and they would have stuff like this. But a lot of times they were paintings, maybe. I don't know that they were photography. And I always really loved this style of imagery, where it's like super muted and it's really graphic. Like you said, the bird kind of really makes this interesting.
But there's so much more going on here. I feel like the post-processing on these close trees is done really tastefully. Like, it's really crunchy. But then you have those layers of the different trees with the fog and everything. And so, I don't know. I love it.
Yeah, very cool.
Next up.
Where in the world is this? This is one of those images where you think like, oh, they've manipulated the colors. But I guarantee, like, I'm almost positive this is probably.
Yeah, I remember he wrote on there where it was and now I don't remember. But, the way he wrote it made it seem like it was real.
Where do you think this is shot from?
I would have to guess a helicopter. Uh-huh. Ready? Three, two, one. Four stars, excellent. You know, whether or not this should be in your portfolio, to me, depends on where you're making your money. If you're a portrait photographer, I probably wouldn't put stuff like this on my website. But if you're a fine artist or landscape photographer, then...
It's funny, cool. We did a fine art critique. Well, you and Mike did a fine art critique that you can find on our channel. And most of the submissions you guys were saying were not fine art
at
all.
Well, you know, it's interesting. So we were just at WPPI and somebody came up to me at WPPI and was like, man, you know, I love your critiques and everything, but what the hell happened with that fine art critique? And I was like, yeah, we didn't get good submissions. And he was like, what are you talking about? There were tons of good submissions. And I said, oh, I didn't look. David was the one who picked the picked the images. He was like, yeah, like half the ones in there weren't even remotely fine art. And there was like 100 submissions that were fine art.
They may have gotten picked after we had filmed, but before we had posted.
Maybe, but I also like blaming David.
The point is that we've already seen a lot of really great, we've had at least four.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Like 2 4-star fine art images.
Here's the other interesting thing. I really feel like David does a good job or a poor job of just choosing like random images. When I have to choose the images, I choose for the most part the ones that I really like or I find really interesting. So when I'm choosing the pictures, they're gonna be higher rated images.
So back to this image, like I feel like the composition's great. It has this leading line that goes through it. The smoke and fog or clouds,
yeah,
like
clouds.
I don't know where this is shot from. That's adding a whole different element. The colors add a different element. I just feel like the colors are a little funky to where I don't know that I would print this large. Like, what kind of room would you put this in? It looks like a Vegas room.
Yeah,
that's
like
got
a hotel or something.
Like something that's got a lot of vibrant colors. I don't know that this would fit anywhere in my house, but I still love it because of that. And if this is all naturally happening, that's a pretty cool location.
Next up. Ready? 3, 2, 1. I gave it 4. I see why you gave it a 3.
I feel like everything's executed well. I just am still looking for like...
Like why is it even photographed?
The purpose, yeah.
Yeah, to me, again, like I guess I'm just choosing all fine art stuff that I really like. I don't know. This weird reflection highlight that's on this building looks so interesting to me. One thing that bothers me about this shot, it feels, and I could be totally wrong if I got this into Photoshop, but it feels like on the very left side, this pillar over here is wider on the top than it is on the bottom. It feels like this shot needs to be skewed out to the upper left just a little bit because it doesn't feel quite square to me.
I'm kind of obsessed with like downtown LA. I almost want to see like Tent City down here.
I mean, that would make it really interesting.
And then it's
too.
Like this luxury thing with, you know, the slums below it, and it would have some kind of social commentary. But the way it is now, black and white conversion's amazing.
Yeah.
It's a cool image. I keep looking at it thinking, I don't know what the story is. It's not fine art enough for me to want to put that on my wall, but I do love what's going on in the middle building.
Next up. Ready?
Ooh.
3, 2, 1. 3 stars. I'm in between a 3 and a 4 on this one. I feel like it's super interesting. Maybe the difference between the highlight and the shadows is a little much.
Like you'd pull the shadows out in the foreground or something?
Maybe. I'm just imagining this as like a really nice large print. And I find it very interesting, but it's just a little lacking for some reason. And it might be, you know, just the Photoshop could use a little bit more detail on the shadows.
Yeah, I honestly can't put my finger on what it would take for this to get a higher rating for me. I kind of want to see more of the scene maybe, or more color in the foliage. Like everything's just green and yellow. I feel like the water line on the bottom is just this little sliver. I don't know. There's something compositionally that just seems a little straightforward to me that keeps this from going any higher for me than a 3.
That I feel the same way. I don't even know if I would consider it straightforward composition. Something feels a little awkward about the composition.
But, I just mean straightforward, like your interest is dead center.
Yeah.
The bottom like is at the, like, was that like 10% water? It just, I don't know, everything just seems like it's just, there's no foreground element, there's really no leading lines, like all of the things that landscape photographers harp on all the time. Like the lighting is really what's working for this, but it's working in a big way.
Ready? 3, 2, 1. I'm in between a 3 and a 4 on this one. I think the foreground looks fantastic. The hazy fogginess of the background is like a little strange to me. And then
it needs more contrast?
I think it does. I love the, you know, light rays, but I just feel like maybe I just want a little bit more detail or a little bit more shadows in that back mountain. And then having these completely blown out clouds up top.
Yeah.
It's not the end of the world.
I can totally see that. Yeah. Like this is probably a 3.5 more realistically. If you take the whole bottom of the image, it looks almost like a completely different image than above. And sometimes that happens naturally. I mean, you just get a difference in exposure. But if you're gonna process this as heavily as I can tell this has been processed, why not pull the sky down a little bit more and then even just burn in some of the shadows or, you know, do something to kind of make that a little more believable, especially like up here where the right side of the hills, make that kind of fade into the foreground to where it pulls you in more than just this. It almost looks like they pin tooled straight across, you know, or did a gradient straight across.
3, 2, 1. I'm in between a 3 and a 4. I gave it a 4. I was going to say, it's really interesting how much we kind of hate on sunset pictures.
Yeah.
But then the second you put a little bitty silhouette in front of the sunset, it's like, I love it now. You know, it's super interesting.
And I think what's interesting about this picture and many other images like that is you've removed everything and really focused on the stuff that's important. So many sunset shots, it's a lake and the cabin's not in the right place and your eye wanders everywhere and it doesn't have the same effect. But when you shoot telephoto like this and you get this, you know, subject matter in front of your camera, do you think they just sat there and waited for these birds?
You know, that's the hard part about an image like this is like how much of it is real and how much of it is fake. If it's fake, then I would suggest kind of fixing the left side of the frame a little bit. I can actually see some detail on the bottom left, which kind of pulls me out of this a little bit. And the foreground is so flat where the guy is standing on the right, and then to have it kind of dip down on the left side and I be able to see the grass over there, it kind of pulls me out of it a little bit. However, if this was really captured in one shot, then well done, you know?
People are gonna hate me for this. We might have to edit this out. But what if that guy had a shotgun pointed up?
Well, the interesting—
It would have like such a crazy story. Cause I feel like—
Here's the problem though. These birds are way closer to the camera than he is. I mean, think about it. Those birds are almost as big as he is.
Yeah.
So—
But he could be shooting back. And then people would be upset about the photographer being in front of...
He's aiming at the photographer.
I'm just trying to think of like how to make a really controversial or talked about image. Maybe he could be fishing. I feel like he's just standing there. It's almost like he's walking down the road.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm just trying to think, what could you do to elevate this to like even a more interesting level? And I feel like it really, it's down to the person. What could they be doing? If you had a family there and the kids pointing at the birds, that could be interesting.
All right, next up. This is the winning shot. We will send you a private message on Fstoppers. You can let us know which tutorial you would like in the Fstoppers store. You can check out all of our tutorials at fstoppers.com/store.
Now, they have won this.
Yep.
Do you think this is over 50 millimeters? Can a 50-millimeter lens be wide? Like, this is a little, I'm a little, I guess it says if the EXIF data is on the image, it will say on our community what this is shot at.
Here's the thing. There wasn't a ton, but there was a lot of non-50-millimeter image submissions. And somehow this one snuck by me.
Maybe this is medium format and...
So, yeah, I don't know. This, you're right. This does not seem like 50 millimeters at all.
Do they still win the tutorial?
Yes, because you tricked me and I fell for it. So you snuck in here. You got lucky. Unless this is, you know, let us know if I'm wrong here. But you're right. I don't think this is 50 millimeters. Let's rate it anyway. 3, 2, 1. Really? You gave it a 4.
I like this. I feel like I've seen a lot of traffic shots and... Maybe the sky is a little crazy. Maybe this intersection. I mean, I don't know. Like, I really like this image for what it is. I like the little cross guy there. Crosswalk man.
Yeah. Something about this shot to me, it's just maybe it's the location. It's probably a lot of it's the location. I just don't really feel like it's well executed, but to like sell yourself with this shot. Something about it's not really working.
There's
for
no
me.
There's no like clear subject matter. I'm trying to think if Mike Kelly took a shot like this and he somehow lit this middle building or was trying to shoot this building, the tall building. Like this could be some kind of like more environmental architectural shot. But your eye, really the subject matter is the intersection with all the cars.
Exactly, exactly. I just feel like this photographer is really good and this location
isn't the best.
Yeah, so that's the reason why I still gave it a 3. It's a solid image, it can be in your portfolio, but I'd love to see more by this guy because I would imagine he's got cooler stuff. 3, 2, 1. Now this is an interesting shot. I've thought about giving this a 5. I absolutely love this, especially for fine art to print and hang on the wall. And you can tell it's all real because there's sensor dust spots all over it. The photographer didn't even take them out.
Interesting.
I didn't notice that until right now, which I guess is kind of impressive.
to be real though. It could just be they blended in a few things and then didn't take out the sensor dust, right? Like that would be crazy if they did that.
That would be weird to like put in tons of work making some fake image and then not.
I mean, if they got
the
this
dust.
Long exposure with the cars, if this is a single long exposure frame, that's pretty damn impressive. Like everything you're saying, like the bridge is perfectly exposed. Like everything in this is perfect. There's nothing that's like overly blown out or super dark.
I know.
I'd be really interested.
That's why
to
I
know
like it so much.
This.
You know, you see so many photos of this bridge and, you know, it just gets old and then boom, something that's totally different and unique and still is the same subject matter, but in a totally different way. So let us know, whoever took this in the comments on Fstoppers. Let us know if this is a single frame and if you did any retouching. And if you did, why didn't you take out the sensor dust? Next up. Is this Dubai? Where is this?
Yes, this is Dubai. I have edited so many time lapses for Elias' Photographing the World tutorial that I know this location very well.
Ready?
Yes.
3, 2, 1. I was in between a 4 and a 5 on this one. This just looks awesome to me.
I love the gradient. Like, if you've ever been to Dubai, it's incredibly difficult to get clear skies. Luckily, we did when we were with Alaya, which was kind of weird. Most of the time, it looks like this. But then, in the foreground, or towards the bottom, I mean, these buildings are really tall. These are probably some of the tallest buildings in the world. I bet you this building here is in the top 40 largest buildings in the world, if not higher. So, what I'm trying to say is that all of this fog that's coming through, it's common, but it's not that common. It probably happens like 10 to 20 times a year.
Yeah.
Which gives this really new age space looking. I mean, this looks like something out of like Avengers or X-Men or something.
I know. I'm interested to know how much of this look is post-processing versus what it really looked like there.
But I bet you it really looked like this.
But I mean, that gradient that's from like the orange to the teal blue up top. It just looks too good. And then, you know, it's got the same kind of tones in the buildings.
They definitely tone mapped it and they've given it a look, but I think you'd be surprised that it looks more like this out of the camera than you would expect. But I mean, I love the leading line across it. I feel like the vantage point's great. I mean, they're obviously in a really tall building. I should know where this is shot. I know Elia would know, like which building they're actually in.
Very well done. Next up.
This is where I wanted to go. Is this the Southern Alps or is this the Dolomites?
I have no idea. It's amazing looking.
Oh my gosh.
Ready?
Yeah.
3, 2, 1.
I'm going to go 5.
Really?
Yeah.
Now,
I don't give 5s often, but
I almost gave this a 3, so I'm
really?
I'm really interested. Here's my issue with it. The mountains look amazing, no doubt. Love the lighting, love the color, love the clouds down below or fog, whatever. The composition is weird to me.
Too much sky?
There's a lot of sky up there. And
the mountains just go through the middle?
To me, I would almost like to see this zoomed in more and for that to be the composition.
I mean, I can see that. And the problem is if I can see that, then does that negate giving something a five?
I don't know. I mean,
can you take a five-star image and then improve that?
I don't know. I think it looks better zoomed in more because I think the most interesting part of this shot is the dark rocks with the sunlight hitting them and then the fog around them. And you don't really need all this sky up there. It's kind of dead space to me. So by zooming in, I just feel like
I can agree with that.
I give it a five at, like that, with a crop like that.
Well, and everything on the left is, you know, those little two mountains aren't really that impressive.
Yeah.
I just, like, I grew up in Alaska and I've seen pictures and paintings like this, and I just always am so envious of these shots. And I feel like this isn't as cliche as so many of the locations that we see. Mm-hmm. Maybe this will be soon. Everyone's gonna travel here and take this picture, but like that's just, gosh, that's like some of the most natural beauty you could come across in nature. I love it. That would be something I could put on my wall. And it's not so over the top where it's been processed to where the sky is exploding and you got the fog. Like this looks like you actually could have been there. And it's subtle enough with the processing that I really love that.
Next up, what were you talking about? Processing?
I love stuff like this that has subtle processing.
Subtle processing. Yeah. Really muted tones.
Muted tones. Yeah, and just the right amount of clarity on the, you know, on the slider.
Like 1,000?
Maybe like 900.
Okay. All right, you ready? 3, 1. This shot's a little overprocessed for me.
Is it?
A little overprocessed for me.
This is one of the most processed images I think I've ever seen on Fstoppers.
It's taken things to new levels of processing.
I mean, like every element of this, like the blue banding at the bottom of the mountains and then the orange and then the cyan sky, like this is a lot. This is a lot to take in.
Yeah.
But all of that being said, I think this actually is a great composition.
In
a cool location.
I agree. And the lighting that's on the barn and on the mountains is kind of interesting.
Gosh, you know? I would love to have this raw file. If they would release this raw file and let the community tweak it. I bet you there's something here.
That's an interesting idea. If you'd like to give up the raw file or at least show what the original image looked like, we'd like to see it. It's funny though, man. Like, there's a photographer here in Charleston. I don't know that they go this far. But they have a gallery on King Street, which is like prime real estate, and they sell prints that look like this.
They make a killing.
So what the hell do we know?
I know. They have every like door and every house in Charleston.
Yeah.
And they do this effect, and they print it on metal.
Yeah.
And I see people walking out of that store all the time.
I was, a few months ago, I was at this local, farmer's market type thing where they have artists and stuff, and my dad was with me and he saw that it was a print that it was kind of like this, and it might have been on the metal.
Was it a series of coasters?
Maybe, I don't remember, but he was like, Lee, how do they do that? And I was like, they push all the sliders to 1,000, like that's how they do it. What are you talking about? All right, next up.
Why do I feel like I've seen this image before? This has not been in a critique before, has it?
I don't know if it's been in a critique before. Maybe it has.
Maybe
I
just...
I think
maybe,
I've seen it on Fstoppers.
Maybe that's where I've seen
it. I think it's been rated by admins, and so I think it's in, like, the circulation.
We have a photographer. Is it Ty that does drone stuff? Ty Poland.
And he has stuff like this?
He has stuff that's got this kind of tone to it, and I've always liked his work.
You ready?
Yep.
3, 2, 1. 4 stars. We agree. I don't know. I mean... It's so freaking simple, but again, for fine art, like this is the type of stuff that I love. I don't want something that's like neon colors in my house. This is the type of stuff that I want to hang on my wall. Just kind of gives you a mood rather than, oh yeah, I know that place.
Yeah, oh, it's so abstract. Like this could be in so many locations in America, probably in the world.
Yeah.
Again, the vantage point is really interesting here.
Vanish point or vantage point?
Vantage point.
Oh.
Pulling a Mike Kelly and just making up words. I guess they could be shooting down from a higher location. This could be a drone, could be a helicopter. I don't really know where they'd be.
Could just be another, you know, the other side of the mountain.
Yeah.
I dig it. Next up. It's interesting. I just noticed something about this shot that I didn't notice before. So I'm gonna rate it a little harder. 3, 2, 1. So I was gonna give this a 4. Yeah, I don't know, but now looking at the upper right-hand corner of this shot, you can see the horizon isn't straight. I didn't notice that before. It almost makes me want to, you know, just grab down here and just pull it up, you know, like stretch that yellow color.
Well, I was almost thinking, and I think a lot of landscape photographers would be upset with this idea, but I almost thought just like, take this yellow and clone it up, and you don't need those mountains at all. I mean, yeah. If you could have those mountains run all the way across the edge of the frame, maybe that would be kind of cool. Mm-hmm. But if you just had this little gradient to where you have no idea how far back the rest of these dunes go, I think that would be really cool because the foreground is so freaking awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. I'd also like to see this in black and white. There's some little yellow speck right in the middle.
There's a few of them.
That's like, kind of driving me crazy. I don't like these ones that are in the bottom left. I don't know what those are, just reflections off the sand or whatever. They don't bother me as much.
It's like a little lens flare.
I'd probably take them out. But this one that's like a green leaf or something, that's really bumming me out. I would clone that one out. This is a tough one because I feel like this is very artistic. And it's like, I kind of want to see it with the other photographer's work. Because I'm about to say like, it's a little overprocessed, but if that is their thing and they're doing this time and time again and they're selling prints like this, then it makes sense to me, you know? All right, are you ready?
Yeah.
I was in between a 3 and a 4. We both give it 3. It's cool. I like it. It kind of feels like the movie we just watched last night.
Black Panther?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
I feel like this image has so much commercial viability. Like this, here, like some of the
sloppy retouching.
Some of the post-production when you zoom in is kind of bad on the trees on the right. There's a lot of haloing. This image has a look that I feel like would sell, you know? And I don't know if that's for
sell
like...
Sell what?
I don't know if people are buying this, but like I could see like a church having this.
Yeah, me too.
I could see an inspirational book having this.
Yeah.
It's not cheesy. From a photographer's standpoint, it might be a little overprocessed, but I could see people spending money on this as like stock photo or, you know, something to be used for like a commercial application. But then when you zoom in like this and you start to see how sloppy some of the retouching is and the compositing.
It's not much, but we're just looking like this bush that's on the right side. Cool. It's a little obvious that there's some white haloing. That's easy to pull out. But my eye went to it without zooming in. They're like, something's not right there.
And like this flare up here, like do flares naturally do that? I mean, sometimes they do. And the shallow
probably
depth of field,
not,
like, I feel like this is had.
That's the whole thing. I think this is supposed to be, like, a dreamy shot. It's not supposed to be realistic.
It's still eye-catching.
Next up. Wish we had higher-res versions of some of these shots, especially ones like these. I just want to be able to zoom in and look at all the buildings. Are you ready?
I think so.
3, 2, 1. 4 stars. Excellent. This looks awesome. I think, you know, this type of thing needs to be printed large and enjoyed from a distance and up close. I hate all of the cranes, but it's like that happens in every city shot now. So then you have to make the decision.
Do you retouch it out, or
do you want it to be realistic? I don't know what the right answer is. I say retouch them out
because they're not going to be there permanently. And
that's what I
on any given season, there's going to be more or less cranes. I hate that this tower here... The city needs to light it better, right? And you feel like that tower is such... Like, that is the predominant part of the skyline, and the whole upper half is dark.
Well, how are they going to light it up there?
They could have lights underneath the viewing tower that point down or something. Like, I just feel like they should get on top of that, right?
Okay.
Sky's great. I mean, this is like the shot you would get the postcard of.
Yeah.
And it, you know, it's got all the detail and everything.
Next up.
This has got to be close to the other shot that we saw, right? Maybe. Are there that many places in the world that look like this?
I don't know. I do not know.
This could be like Norway or something. It could be a completely different country, but...
Ready?
Yep.
3, 2, 1. Four stars, excellent. Looks great to me. I personally have a little bit of a problem with the stars being blurry. What is your thought on like focus stacking the stars here? Like, I would imagine that some serious retouching has been put into this image. So I would infer that the photographer would not have a problem focus stacking. What is your thought on that?
You know, I don't know that I have a problem with that. I think, like, if you're a purist, you probably want every single thing in focus. I don't really have a problem with stars having a tail or with them being perfectly stationary and sharp. Or I don't really love the whole star trail thing that a lot of photographers do. But if you focus on the foreground and let the stars go out of focus like you naturally would have with depth of field, I personally don't really have a problem with that. I think it looks cool.
You like them slightly blurry like this. It's just a little more realistic.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I feel like it makes the depth of field look correct, and it makes it more about the mountains than the stars. Hmm. But if you sharpened everything by focusing and focus stacking, I don't know. I think that's just kind of an artistic decision. Either way, it doesn't really bother me.
Now let's take a quick second and try to figure out how this image was created, because I would assume that the light on the mountains here is from the moon. But then we have this yellow halo in the background, which I would imagine is a sunset. But if you look at the shadows that are on these rocks, I don't imagine that it's possible to get these rocks looking that dark and that sky that bright. And yeah. I definitely don't think it's possible to get that little yellow bit on the horizon and get the stars and the galaxy and stuff in your shot.
I would tend to agree.
But
I love that. I feel like...
I do. I do too. I think it's made the image really interesting.
They've taken an earlier sunset and kind of painted that in. And then they've taken a later star shot and painted that in.
Yeah.
Because I would imagine your blacks wouldn't be as dark if you shot the sky at the same time as the sunset.
Right.
But you never know. Like, we've been out on location where the moon's out, and it does weird things, like things you wouldn't predict, you know?
Yeah, let us know in the comments how you shot it. All right, so this was the last image. As you guys saw earlier, I somehow forgot to put in number 10, so we just had 19 today. But I think because I picked the images, these were some of the highest rated shots we've ever critiqued so far. Again, guys, if you want to submit your pictures for the next critique, anything to do with portraits, head over to the link below on YouTube or in the Fstoppers page. And if you'd like to check out our full length photography tutorials, figure out what you would like to win, head over to fstoppers.com/store.